So good evening and a very warm welcome to the Royal Geographical Society and to our third annual lecture. My name's Marina Cantacuzino and I'm the founder and director of the Forgiveness Project, and I'm absolutely delighted to welcome today our main speaker, Dr. Gwen Adshead, who's also going to be joined by other important contributors, Marion Partington, Erwin James and Kamal Pavanich, who will all share a part of their own personal story. At the heart of everything we do at the Forgiveness Project are the real stories of victims and perpetrators of crime and violence, and this event is no exception. So by way of introduction about the Forgiveness Project, I don't want to go on for too long. There is a leaflet on your chairs, so and you can look at the website. But just to sum up, we have three main areas of work. We work in prisons. We run an intervention which comes under the Victim Empathy Restorative Justice umbrella and is facilitated by both ex-offenders and victims of crime. And those of us who work in the prisons absolutely know the transformative nature that goes on there. So I'm really delighted that very soon we're going to be publishing an independent evaluation from Middlesex University's Forensic Psychological Services, which really shows some very encouraging results and strong evidence of the impact that we have, both generally and in terms of changing offenders' attitudes towards offending and towards crime. So that's really exciting. And schools, for the last 2 years, we have been developing and filming a resource for teachers that is going to be used mainly in the classroom. We did this because right from the beginning of the Forgiveness Project, which was 2004, teachers were emailing the whole time and saying, we're using these stories in the classroom, it's the best form of teaching, do you have a resource? So finally we got funding from the Paul Hamlin Foundation, and we're going to be launching that in January, and it will be a way of spreading our message and our resources far wider among young people. And the third area is really around storytelling and story collecting. We've got over 100 stories of victims and perpetrators of crime and violence from all over the world on the website. We have an exhibition called The F Word, Images of Forgiveness, which we hire out in various countries. And I should also mention that we are running a diploma now. We're into our second year, and that's really exciting. And there will be much more information about that on the bookstall after if you're interested. And that's closely aligned to our work. I just want to explain why we chose this subject. Evil has always been of great fascination to me, the subject, this unflinching moral absolute. The question of, you know, to put it very, very simply, why good people turn bad. And about a year after I founded the Forgiveness Project, I came across a quote by Solzhenitsyn, the author, and the Soviet prisoner of conscience, and it totally summed up the ethos, the philosophy of the Forgiveness Project. And this is where the subject of this lecture really came from, and this was the quote: if only there were evil people somewhere insidiously committing evil deeds, and it were necessary only to separate them from the rest of us and just destroy them. But the line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being, and who is willing to destroy a piece of his own heart. And I love that quote, and it really does form the basis of everything that we do. And another much more personal reason why I was interested in this subject, that I was reading the letters of my Romanian grandfather, which were recently translated by my aunt, and I never met him. He died in 1960, and he was a political prisoner. He was in prison for about 6 years after the Second World War, and he wasn't allowed ever to get out from behind the Iron Curtain, and he never met again with his wife and children. And so I was reading these letters, and there was one about evil and wickedness, so I was really interested in it. And I expected to read words of resentment, because it was very, very hard what he went through. And this one line stood out for me, and he said, "I think of evil as inherent in human nature, the natural shadow cast by good." So when I read that, and then I remembered that I had heard Gwen on Desert Island Discs 2 years ago, and I'd written to her, because it was brilliant what she said, and I said it's very much within the ethos of the Forgiveness Project. And she very generously wrote back, and rather fateful words at the end were, "If there's ever anything I can do to help you." So I'm delighted now to introduce Dr. Gwen Adshead, forensic psychiatrist and psychotherapist at Broadmoor High Security Psychiatric Hospital.
Well, it gives me enormous pleasure to be here with you tonight. It's a privilege to be associated with the Forgiveness Project. And when I wrote that email to Marina, I really meant it, although I didn't quite expect that I'd be here with such a wonderful, huge, great group of people here to think and reflect on the subject of forgiveness, and in particular, some thoughts about evil. And what I'm going to share with you are literally just some thoughts and some speculations that are based on my work working with people who've done terrible things to others. And I have learned an enormous amount since I first started working in Broadmoor many years ago, and I'm still learning all the time. And I want to start just by acknowledging the work of my colleagues, the team of psychotherapists and psychologists with whom I work, without whom we would not be able to do the work that we do. I also want to acknowledge the contribution of the men who attend the homicide group that I've been running for over 8 years, and their willingness to share their experiences and to give me permission to use their words and thoughts, not all of which are here today, but in general, which have informed my work. So when we start to think about evil, I think it's very important that we remind ourselves that evil is right here in the midst of our lives, in our human history. And although we have always often wanted to demonize it, I think it's important to remember that evil deeds and evil states of mind come in many forms and are universal. And this comes from one of the Holocaust history websites. And for those of you who don't know, the gentleman sitting behind the flowers is Franz Stangl. And Franz Stangl oversaw the deaths of 900,000 people at Treblinka. So if you're interested in states of mind that cause great suffering and cruelty to others, I think it's quite important to start with people like Franz Stangl, and I was very influenced by the wonderful biography of Franz Stangl written by the late and much missed already Gita Sereni. Now, Cecil Day Lewis, the poet laureate, wrote about love as a kind of necessity, and I have often found myself wondering whether the concept of evil is also somehow necessary to our social life. Do we need a concept that recognizes the dark matter in every human heart, which is present everywhere, but perhaps like dark matter in the universe, very hard to see? One thing we know is, like many complex human subjects, the more you start to look at it, evil is very hard, it's quite hard to define. I take the view that it is a specifically human activity, that nature is not moral and is not evil. Terrible things happen in tsunamis and cyclones and tornadoes, but this is not evil. And this is a philosophical shift that was made in the 19th century after the Great Madrid earthquake. And I think it's worth holding on to. I think it's a useful distinction. I think that there are aspects of evil that are recognizable, that they are something about consciousness, something of planned, considered, exploitation of the vulnerable. I think this is a crucial point, and we'll come, no doubt come back to it again and again, the exploitation of the vulnerable, and how it is that any of us learn about the discrepancies of power and lack of concern for suffering. And also what emerges, I think, when one talks to people who've been in evil states of mind is something about the extent to which the self is the only concern. Nobody really exists but you. And some of you may have read Christopher Booker's wonderful book, The Seven Basic Plots, which is about the stories that we tell in our human history. And one of those stories is, he thinks, is about the monster that threatens the community. That many of our favorite stories whether they be bedtime stories, fantasies, ancient stories, current stories, is about the monster that threatens the community and the quest of a hero, indeed heroine, sometimes both, to overcome the monster and save the community. But these days we might think about the monster within rather than the monster without, and the extent to which each of us is a community of selves, threatened by our own monsters. But I think there is a performative aspect to the use of the term evil. When we call somebody evil, I think we're making a judgment about their state of mind. And the wish to hurt, clearly the wish to hurt somebody else is a feature of that state of mind. I think that's pretty much goes without saying. But it doesn't always have to act and result in an act of physical violence. And that's worth thinking about too. What we think about minds that want to hurt other people but never actually manifest themselves in an act of physical cruelty. What would we think about those states of mind? And this is important, I think, because evil states of mind are probably common, whereas serious violence is not. Now, you may think, now, hang on a minute. Not common. It's every day in the newspapers. And it's an uncommon way to break the law. And actually, of all the time, violence to other people is quite an unusual way for people to break the criminal law if they're going to do that. It's not universal, and it needs an explanation, and evil states of mind are only one explanation. But not all evil people are violent, and I'd like to suggest to you that not all violent people are evil or in evil states of mind. So we could move a little towards a definition, perhaps, that looks a little bit like this, but this is absolutely work in progress, and so all thoughts are welcome. I think it's got to include something about intentional suffering inflicted on the vulnerable. I think it's got to include a response in the perpetrator of contempt for that cruelty and suffering, contempt for the distress that suffered. Both the cruelty and the contempt are positively supported, not only by the perpetrator, but often by the perpetrator's colleagues and friends and people that they know. Indeed, many of the acts of evil that we most frighten us, the states of mind that most concern us, are where more than one person is involved. And it seems that cruelty and contempt for vulnerability is actively supported or even applauded. And finally, I think we may want to think about acts that evoke that type of judgment in us, that this person is anti-human, not part of the group that we call human, someone that we want to exclude from the group that we call humanity. Again, I can't overemphasize that I think it's very important not to confuse evil with all violence and all aggression. This is not to say that violence is desirable or that aggression is desirable, but rather that these are importantly different concepts in quite important ways, and it's important not to slip from one to the other. And I've been very influenced by a wonderful philosopher called Mary Midgley, who's written in this field. I think key things, though, are the lack of emotional contact and the lack of emotional engagement and concern for distress. But this is complex, because we know that perpetrators of evil often do have other lives in which they appear to be full of affect and warmth and attention to others, that these are not people who are always devoid of empathy. And even some of the most disturbed men that I have seen, and women for that matter, are not people who are, as it were, 100% without empathy or concern. But it is true that at that moment when they were hurting somebody else, it's as if the capacity for empathy was just turned off completely. And again, I emphasize the exploitation of the vulnerable, because I think for the perpetrator, that is about denying their own vulnerability. And yet each one of us has been vulnerable and will be vulnerable. It's not possible to have a long and happy human life without being vulnerable. And I think that exploitation and attack on vulnerability is about a type of fear and distress and panic. And I think we see it in societies, and sometimes we see it here in our own society, in which we have a denigration of the vulnerable. pull yourself together. Each man for himself. That's the way to make a strong society. That sort of talk in which we have a denigration of vulnerability. So I come back now just to think about this notion of a performative function of the concept of evil. Because actually, people often ask me, well, do you use the word evil in your clinical work? And the answer is no, almost never. The men sometimes use it. We only have men in the hospital now, and the men sometimes use it, nearly always in a way to describe themselves and what they've done. But we don't use it at all. But judges use it quite often. It's often a word, and that's where I think it's a word of power that judges use to communicate something about what we, the largest group, feel about people who've hurt one of our number. But I think we can see how it's used to make a very statement. There was a very sad story of a woman who killed her disabled daughter several years ago, and her ex-husband said of her, no doubt speaking from a position of great pain and great distress, said of her, she is pure evil. And then of another a headline in the paper about John Venables, who some of you will remember, who killed a child when he was 11 years old. The headline was, My Vile Life. And I wonder what on earth he made of that when he saw the newspaper, if he saw the newspaper, but newspapers are in prisons, are in secure hospitals. And what does it mean to see a picture of yourself with the line above it that says, My Vile Life? And I wonder, it seems to me there's something being said here about who these people are and naming them and excluding them, just as Marina was quoting in Solzhenitsyn's famous quote, if only we could name and label these people and put them somewhere right out where we could be sure that they were, and then we'd be safe. Their vile lives would be somewhere else. I think that what I've been learning is that something about the perpetration of evil includes a failure of the human, a failure to be human. And that could be a dysfunction of the social mind. This is the concept of social mind described by Paul Gilbert and Robin Dunbar. Victims seen as fair game, a predator state of mind. And this is interesting because, of course, we have an animal heritage, and perhaps a predator state of mind has been important in a past history in a different form. But we don't treat each other as prey, and very few people do operate as predators. But the metaphor of fair game is, of course, straight out of the hunting literature of a subject, of an animal that's fair game and an animal that's not fair game. And I think certainly I have worked with men who clearly saw some people as fair game. And again, I come back to the contempt for vulnerability that undermines social bonding. That if we're bonded together in common bonds, that means that we accept each other as both strong and weak, richer for poorer. That notion of being connected and contempt for vulnerability fatally undermines those bonds. So we can create narratives of evil. If we wanted to get into an evil state of mind, this is how we could do it. We could create narratives that dehumanize other people, that legitimize hatred. We could create stereotypes about what a legitimate victim was and what would be acceptable violence to those people that we deem to be fair game. We could have a discourse that talks up differences between people and talks down the similarities between us. We could have the creation of monster stories. And actually, I think we've had a little bit of a monster story in the last 48 hours in relation to the ex-CEO of Barclays. I hold no brief for Mr. Diamond, but I think there's something here about the creation of monster stories which is interesting. And then, of course, for those of us who are really interested in evil, there's the question of the distinction between the state and the individual. I work with individuals who've committed acts that are cruel and unusual. But what do we make of states? And this is where I started, of course, with the picture of Franz Stangl, just to remind us of what happens if the state gets into an evil state of mind. One of the things that we often think about, too, is whether people who committed acts of evil have always been traumatized themselves. And I think that it is sometimes true, but it may not always be true. And that's interesting, it seems to me, because it invites speculation about different pathways to an evil state of mind. What would count as injury or trauma? And maybe it's about being ready to see the pain or the trauma in other people's histories. And who gets to decide? Who creates the narratives of trauma as well as the narratives of hatred? And again, some of you will be familiar with this. This is something I come back to again and again when we talk about evil and madness, because of course the hospital that I work in was for a lot of its history. We're 152, I think, this year, and the hospital that I work in has often been somewhere has been, you know, the labels and epithets about evil are often applied to it. But of course, the men I work with are grievously mentally ill, are psychologically very disabled, are people who lack really many of the talents and strength, psychological strengths that we hold dear and value and possess. And here are 15 men like us, warm, intelligent, educated, at the peak of their professions. They were people who were in charge. They were the government. And for those of you who don't know them, this is the 15 men who were present at the Wannsee Conference 70 years ago. And these 15 men planned the final solution. They organized the policies and organization and the laws required to eradicate a subgroup of the populace who had done absolutely nothing. And all this with a war on. A war on two fronts going on. These 15 men got together in a nice villa to plan killing millions of people. Now, I don't think we have any evidence that these men were traumatized. I don't think we have any evidence that they were abused as children or they were mentally ill. But we do know that they created a narrative between them, a narrative that made it possible to do what they did. And what I've noticed when I talk to people who've done terrible things, and this is in, if you've not read Gita Sereny's book, Into That Darkness, about Franz Stangl, it's definitely worth a read, because what she talks about is the question of agency and ownership. And what we often find in the hospital is that when people arrive in the hospital, they often blame their victims. Sometimes they even take pride in what they've done. They seem quite remorseless. And there's very little sense of blameworthiness or guilt. And that seems to us to be a type of cover story, to cover the shame and the distress and the fear and the hatred, hatred of everybody, hatred of us, hatred of themselves. And sometimes they have some social support, not so much in the hospital that I work in, but in prisons you can meet men who find some social support for their views. They're not alone in what they think. But gradually, when we're working with people, we try to get them to, as it were, deconstruct their cover story and develop a new story in which they take their own agency for what they've done very seriously indeed. And here I'd be very influenced by the work of Professor Shad Maruna, who I think is here tonight, whose work on the desistance from crime emphasizes the language of agency, how important it is that men, and indeed women, can own this thing of darkness. And for those of you who don't know it, this is from The Tempest, this notion of acknowledging this of darkness. And forgiveness is something that comes up a lot in the work that we do in the hospital, because many of our people would like very much to be forgiven. And of course, we're not in a position to do that in the hospital. But we talk about what it might be to be forgiven. We talk about what the process of forgiving involves. And I've been influenced here by the work of Paul Gilbert, who talks about some very important things, I think, here for us to think about in relation to forgiveness, which is that it's not about accepting, necessarily, and it's not about submission or liking the offender or feeling close to them or even feeling warm and fuzzy feelings towards them. But it's something about not engaging with hatred. Now, that is a big ask, each person must find their own way. But there, it seems to me that there's something here about rejection of hate as a solution and compassion for one's own hatred and distress. And that we are beginning to be interested in the hospital about the use of mindfulness practice, and particularly those compassion practices that encourage the attention of compassion for even those most horrible feelings such as hatred and distress. So how can we do this? How can we transform people's life narratives when they've done something terrible? Well, the work is slow. And we have to take one word at a time sometimes. But witnessing and acknowledging suffering, I think, is a crucial part of that. And that's one of the reasons that we set up the homicide group, was to help the men begin to articulate something about their own acknowledgement of what they had been present at and caused, and a willingness to listen and explore. I heard the chief rabbi speaking yesterday on the radio about the word hearken, shema, the idea of listening, being very present and attentive, that type of hearkening and listening, which is a type of engagement. And group support's important. For offenders, group support's very important because most of our people feel very socially isolated and excluded. And they have been excluded for all sorts of very understandable reasons. But to reconnect with other human beings is crucial in the process. And we have to be thoughtful about outrage and hatred. The men in the first year of our homicide group, the men spent a lot of time talking about what the people say. And they meant the newspaper and the Sun, but they also meant, what do people say about us? When we leave the hospital, what will people say about us? What will they say to us? And this, of course, a quote from a famous literary murderer. This is from Macbeth, but is the most beautiful example of a psychologically acute problem. I am afraid to think what I have done. And you might like to imagine what it would be like to be afraid to think. And this is a big problem for many of our people in the hospital, and that's, of course, what a work of the psychological therapies is about. It's about helping people get to a place where they could feel safe enough to think. So this is a quote from one of the men in the homicide group. The story I tell now is not what I told then. That's one man. And then the bit in white is somebody else. I feel I'm stuck in my previous age, the age I was when I did my offense. Time's passing here. And there are things I'm not doing. I want to capture time with magazines and pictures to show what I was doing when I was here. What will it be like in 10 years' time? Where will we be? What will I think on my deathbed about this time? And this is a young man who committed his act of homicide when he was still very young and is now somewhat older. And I think you will agree that this is evidence of a mind working on something, a mind raising important questions. This is a mind that is not content just to stay with, that's a terrible thing, it was grim, can we move on? Which is what somebody else in the group said to me the other week. Which is, again, very human understandable. It was grim, can we move on? No. Well, no, actually, Jim, we can't move on. But here is somebody, I think you'll agree, actively engaging with reflection on what it is to have done a terrible thing and what he will think about himself in the future. So in the psychological therapy programs that we offer in the hospital, particularly for people who've killed, we are looking to try and help them take responsibility and to move from a position where they say, it wasn't me, it was my illness, to saying, it was me. It was me. That was the old me, and now I want to engage and see if I can engage into a different kind of me and make different kind of choices. And that means telling a new story of what they are. And some of you will know this quote, that not what thou art seest God with his merciful eyes, but what thou wouldst be. And I think it's that notion of telling a story of what thou wouldst be is an important part of the psychological therapies for offenders that we engage with in the hospital. So we try and help people rework their narratives of passivity into narratives of agency. So instead of being done to by your illness or done to by the actions of your victim, you look and take responsibility for your own destructive feelings. We encourage people to take different perspectives, including the victims, but not just the victims, their own families' perspectives. An acceptance of their offender identity. They have to accept before they can move on. That's a good rule for all psychological change. We can't change unless we accept where we are. And so much of our resistance to change is about resisting accepting where we are. And we try and work on preventing the creation of monsters. And actually, there's a whole other talk to give about the prevention of the creation of monsters. And here's a last quote from one of the men in our group. "If I can make something of my life, then she will not have died in vain, and two lives will not be lost." And on that note, I'm going to finish. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Gwen, so much for that fascinating and humane insight into this subject. I'm now asking one by one each of the three speakers to share briefly a little over 5 minutes each, which is an almost, they were saying in the green room, an impossible thing, but I'm going to be quite strict. First of all, Marion Partington. I met Marion in 2003 originally when I was collecting stories, which then became the F word, Stories of Forgiveness exhibition, stories from victims, perpetrators from around the world. And Marion's sister, Lucy Partington, was the first, one of the victims of Frederick and Rosemary West. And Marion has been on a journey of healing ever since. And she's really actually one of the stories in the Forgiveness Project, which has really informed my own understanding of forgiveness. And I was really delighted last year when I was invited by Valor Publishing to write the foreword of her really quite outstanding book, If You Sit Very Still, which is actually going to be on sale afterwards if you're interested. And I'll hand over to Marion.
Thanks, Marina. And thank you, Gwen. I found that really fascinating. Yes, I've been trying to create a narrative of healing from a story that one I undoubtedly could label as the collision between my sister, whose aspirations were towards medieval art, and she was studying English literature at university and hoping to go on and to the Courtauld Institute, and Frederick and Rosemary West, who had a different agenda. And I sometimes use the word collision in relation to this terrible clash of worlds. It would be easy to label them as evil and write them off, and yet I've never used the word evil about them. I do have a sense, I'm always interested in healing and in the power of words, because I too was studying English literature. And I feel that the word evil is one of those words that I've called in the book the barnacled words, words that get encrusted with meanings and overuse and have sometimes, in this case, tabloid associations that don't actually help us to move towards connecting with the reality that actually I prefer to say that we talk about crimes against humanity. I think that they're actually crimes within humanity, and that we need to approach this kind of behavior, these states of mind, and to understand a bit more about how they're coming about. So I sometimes call this journey that I've been thinking about and writing about for the past 18 years as traveling from the frozen silence, from a place where there aren't any words, because it's unspeakable, and also in our case, because we didn't know what had actually happened to Lucy for 20 years. So there was that layer, huge layers of ice to melt when we did find out. But towards this place that I call the shining silence, which is really the place where healing is possible. So Lucy loved words. I'd like to place you in a bit in the world that she loved by using some of her words. She wrote poetry, And this is a poem I use when I work in prisons with people who've committed serious crime, which is what's an outcome of an inner journey that I had to go on to look within myself to face what it was that kept me from knowing this place that Lucy describes. She says, "Things are as big as you make them. I can fill a whole body, a whole day of life, with worry about a few words on one scrap of paper. And yet the same evening, looking up, I can frame my fingers to fit the sky in my cupped hands." Very soon after she, what we used to call, disappeared in 1973, I had a dream. And that dream has formed the core of this place that I know actually is a possible place for healing, a possible place where forgiveness would be spontaneous. And in the dream, she came back and she said, I said, "Well, where have you been?" And she said, "I've been sitting in a water meadow." And then she said the words, "If you sit very still, you can hear the sun move." And I experienced in the dream and waking up from the dream a feeling of profound peace, the peace that passeth understanding. And I knew that in that place, one would be naturally well-wishing to others. And I felt that it was a taste of my true nature. So the language of the West was expressed through their actions in many ways. And I read a wonderful book called Violence, Reflections on Our National Epidemic by a psychologist who works in prisons called James Gilligan, an American. And he spoke about the logic of shame, and that really helped me in beginning to take steps towards what is unavoidable and essential and extremely painful and difficult, which is this need to find what Stephen Cherry, who's written a wonderful book called Healing Agony, calls a distasteful empathy. So what the West did to Lucy was in some way done to them, and what they couldn't express in words because they didn't have the language came out through actions. So when I was listening at the Rosemary West trial to the details of what was done to Lucy, this word dismembered struck me. And all the words that I didn't really want to connect with seemed to begin with dis. So I looked up this prefix, dis, and it means apart, asunder. And then I thought about the direction that I was hoping to move in, and I thought, I need to remember what has happened. I need to remember the beauty of Lucy's life. And I looked up the prefix re, and it means afresh, anew. So that was the direction of the journey. And during the Rosemary West committal trial, the only words that actually connected with the world I really knew were when we were told that Rosemary West had tried to lure one of the other young women to live in their home, and she'd said that they had a farm in the country and that if she came to live with them, she could go to the farm and write poetry and ride horses. And those were both activities that Lucy was involved in, and I actually began to sweat. But this whole business of the right words, finding the right words, having an ability with words seems to be very much connected to the process of healing, finding a voice. And I feel that my journey towards knowing what is within me, the parts of me that possibly I would rather edit out, as I've said. There's a chapter in the book called Enfolding the Dark, and it's something to do with looking deep within. I went on silent Buddhist retreats, investigating my own mind, trying to understand the root of my own violence, and making a vow to try and move towards forgiving the West. And the first thing I experienced was murderous rage. So this is the actual dimension of the journey, that the terrible reality of what I hoped to move towards involved actually facing the parts of myself that I felt less proud of, less comfortable with. So over the years of going on the retreats, I did reach a moment of what I would call authentic compassion for Rosemary West, when I understood something, the cage of her own suffering, the cage of her fear and her impotence and her isolation. And eventually, after working in prisons for a while, I felt that I'd reached the stage after 10 years where I wanted to write to her and tell her something of the journey that I'd been on, and to let her know that I did wish her well. But it took me 4 years to actually send the letter off, because I had a fear that there would be no response, and I felt that I needed to have no expectations, that this gesture really did need to come from a place of unconditional compassion, empathy with her suffering. So I did send it off, and I received a reply, which was that MS West wishes you to be informed, this was from the security, that she does not wish to receive any further correspondence from you. What did I want to tell her in the letter? I really wanted to tell her that because of what had happened to Lucy, because of her actions, I'd actually had to look deep within and learn something much more profound about my own humanity than I would never have had to do if this hadn't happened. And I wanted her to know that I always try to connect with her as a human being, that I've never wanted to demonize her, I sent her an image that I'd experienced at the end of a retreat, which was a branch weighed down with snow, and I'd brushed against the branch and all the snow had fallen off and the branch had sprung back to where it was meant to be. And so I described this image, and I said that our lives are interconnected, and that I send you the springing of the branch.
Thank you. Thank you, Marion. Marion comes into prisons with us and shares her story with prisoners, has been doing it for a number of years, along with other people who have also experienced deep suffering. And in a way, it's to illustrate redemptive healing. So I'm going to now hand over and ask Erwin James to come up and talk. Erwin is a writer and Guardian columnist. Many of you, I'm sure, know about him. For many years, he wrote a column, A Life Inside, from prison, where he served 20 years of a life sentence for murder. And I'm very grateful to Erwin to coming here tonight and sharing the stage with all of us and sharing something of his journey and some of his views on this subject. Thank you, Erwin.
Thank you, Marion. Thank you very much. Well, I have to say that standing in the shadow of Marianne's grief is a very difficult place to stand. I've been living in the shadow of the grief of people affected by my crimes for almost 30 years. When I went to prison in 1984, it was a great relief that my vile life, as Gwen described earlier on, had come to an end. I was relieved that that life was over. I went into the prison system with no hopes or aspirations, no sense of anything positive could ever come from my experience in prison. I was in Wandsworth prison for a year in 1985. My abiding memory of Wandsworth is Christmas 1985, when the man in the cell above mine hanged himself. And I saw that, actually. I never really considered. I had thought about, self-inflicted death a number of times before my imprisonment. Once I was in jail, I was so sort of numb to come to terms with how I'd become what I'd become that didn't occur to me until the man in the cell above mine hanged himself. And then I saw a way out. But I hung on. You know, I'd been sentenced to life imprisonment. And I somehow had a strong will to live. And so I sort of kept going. You know, I was moved onto a high security prison. I was a Cat A prisoner for a number of years. And I went to my first long-term high security prison. And I met a psychologist there, a prison psychologist, who spent a couple of years risk assessing me and people like me on the wing. And during that time, she persuaded me I had some value. I'd never really thought of myself as being valuable, or having worth, or having any sort of anything that was meaningful, really. And she persuaded me, she cajoled me to go on education classes. She said, you've got to get an education, you've got to train your mind, you've got to think clearly about the future, there are possibilities here. And I said, Joan, her name was Joan Branton, I said, I'm too thick for education. I'd been brought up to completely convinced that I had no capacity to be educated or to be someone who could have a place in society. I said, I'm too thick. She said, you owe it to your victims. You owe it to your victims. And so, I've never ever shared this with anybody really before, but that made me decide to tentatively join an education class. And even when I was a little boy, I was good at English, but I don't know why, because I had a very dysfunctional, chaotic childhood. But at school, I shone at English. And so I joined the English class in the prison. Of course, within a few months, I was top of the class, but it's not hard in prison to be top of the class. So that's not a boast, I've got to tell you. But I couldn't wait to get back to Joan Branton to show her my certificate, my O-level, grade A in English. You know, I'd achieved something in my life. And it spurred me on whenever there was, it was very hard to discover good things about myself after I'd proved to myself that I was beyond redemption. You know, I'd spent my whole life lying, cheating, deceiving. That seemed to be the way that, you know, I thought of myself as a criminal. And it was Joan Branton, the psychologist, who persuaded me I was a human being first, you know. And I was a valuable human being. And throughout the prison journey, you know, there were the usual sort of riots and the occasional killing and other stuff that wasn't very palatable. Lots of boredom, lots of banality, lots of unpleasantness. Good number of members of staff who I gravitated towards, who were life enhancers, you know. People who I got my value system really from prison staff. A couple of prisoners that I became friends with. And I found a better way to live in prison. That was my thing. I thought, I've got to find a way to live in here that's better than how I lived outside. And I used my writing. You know, I became known in prison as the guy that could write a good letter. So I found a place in a community that I'd never really had. And that drove me on over the years, ups and downs. You know, I wasn't a goody-goody, but I wasn't a baddie-baddie. I just tried to make some sense of how I'd become what I'd become. What I came to believe was that I hadn't been born bad. You know, I've got a photograph of myself on my desk, of me and a little boy in a cowboy suit and a pair of baseball boots and a curly head of hair and a big smile, a cheeky kid. I don't look like somebody who was ever born to cause the grief that I caused. And I hang on to that picture, that image. I'm thinking about it now because I'm a little bit disconcerted being amongst you all and being with Marianne and Kemal. You know, I'd rather not be in these shoes, if I'm honest. But I am. And I just keep going. You know, I just do the best I can, really. I owe that to my victims. I don't expect any sort of credit or any sort of approval for that. I know there are people out there now who are suffering because of me. And I'm living. And I have a life. And that's very difficult. I've been out of prison for 8 years now. It's very difficult to come to terms with that. I enjoy sunny days and my victims don't. I could spend another all evening sharing with you the vagaries of having succeeded into a life worth living from the most appalling, destructive behavior. But that's our system. You know, our system, we don't execute people. It's been put to me that I should have been executed a number of times. And my response, well, you know, initially I wasn't, what can I say? I wouldn't have minded at the time. And I really, honestly wouldn't. Even now, I'm not sure that I would resist that much if calls were put up to have me executed, you know. But it's not on the statute books. I took what was coming. I've interviewed people on death row in America. One person in particular, 2 hours before he was executed, he was on death row for 22 years. And then they killed him, and I thought, you know, it's very confusing to think that here in this country, we, despite our hard line towards people who cause us harm and distress, we give people a chance, and I was given a chance to live again. And I'm grateful for that. But I'll tell you this, I did those 20 years without complaint. It hasn't done anything to make me feel any less guilty, less culpable, less remorseful, less shameful, less responsible. I did the 20 years. I'm not sure where it fits in to the equation of my life journey. But I'm here to support Marina and anyone here who's looking for sort of healing and answers and that sort of thing. I wish you all well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Erwin. Erwin doesn't work with us in prisons, but we have a number of ex-offenders who do, some of whom have similar stories, and I think you can see how effective that is. These men that we work with model an image of how prisoners can become once they're out, and without them, the work would not be half as effective. I'm now going to invite Kemal Pavanich to come up. I met Kemal a few years ago. I read an article in a newspaper about him. He is a survivor of the notorious Omarska concentration camp during the Bosnian War and escaped to England in 92 and now returns frequently to Bosnia, where he runs a charity which aims to build bridges of understanding and tolerance, bringing different ethnic groups together, working particularly with young people. And like Marian, Kemal does a lot of talking for us in schools and has come into prisons as well. Thank you.
It's a privilege to be here tonight, and I want to thank Marina for inviting me to speak here. I've been involved in a number of projects, but for me, and I know that I'm actually quite harsh, quite critical and quite judgmental, so for me to say that this is actually one of the best projects that I've been involved in, I know you don't need convincing about that, otherwise you wouldn't be here tonight. But nevertheless, it is important to emphasize what's obvious. My story is a little bit different from what you've heard so far, because it's about a large number of people who committed what we call, or what we may call, acts of evil. And in a way, it's a story which tells you how I actually don't like the word evil, but it's a story which at least in my opinion, proves that there's a capacity for evil in all of us. I was born in a, I would say, in a beautiful community. It was a multicultural society, and we had really a good life. Many different nationalities, ethnic groups lived in former Yugoslavia, and there was always a lot of emphasis on shared values, positive values, that existed in that community and that exist actually in all different parts of the world. So there was this sense of togetherness, and we had good free healthcare, we had a good free education, we had full employment. And when I started my school, for example, I knew which of my classmates were Serbs or Croats, but it didn't really matter, and especially to my generation, because I bought into this new identity that our former leader in former Yugoslavia, Tito, tried to promote, a Yugoslav identity. And I remember when I was, I think, in my third or in my fourth year in my middle school, when our history teacher asked us to identify ourselves by our nationality or ethnicity, and everyone felt really, really ashamed, because our identity is important to us, but in our society, it wasn't a very important question. And this actually, society started eroding towards late 1970s, when, and this is very important because we experienced first signs of a serious economic crisis. And, you know, very often people ask me how come that what happened in former Yugoslavia could happen overnight, and then I try to explain that it didn't happen overnight. It takes a long time to condition people to accept that their neighbors may be their enemies. So this was a gradual process in former Yugoslavia. It took many, many years. And you see, at the beginning, we had individuals who were trying to promote nationalism, but it wasn't state-sponsored. And when it became actually state-sponsored, when most of you have heard of Slobodan Milošević, realized that this was something he could use to his own advantage, then things actually became much, much worse. And when I'm talking about this particular kind of violence leading to wars, massacres and so on, for me personally, propaganda plays a key role, because those who use it, they dehumanize, first of all, future perpetrators, who then in turn can demonize individuals like myself. And when we are no longer human in their eyes, then it becomes easy for them to kill me. Like I said to you, I shared my classroom with people from different backgrounds, and there was one particular individual that I played football with in my primary school. And then when we continued our education in our town, he went to the same school. He was on a different course. So when we came across each other, we'd stop and talk and share a joke and so on. But towards the end of 1980s, when this economic crisis accelerated and people started losing jobs, and you know, the propaganda was really incredible. On one occasion, I saw him coming towards me, and he didn't stop. He didn't even look at me, and I was really confused. I didn't understand what was going on. So by this point in time, Mirko, whose name ironically means peace, he was already a victim. He was already dehumanized. And unfortunately, we had several wars in former Yugoslavia, and then it happened in Bosnia as well. And I didn't want to believe that it would ever reach my village or my town. Unfortunately, it did. It was a terrible shock. I was taken to this place called Omarska, where I went to school, where my GP was, where I would go to do, you know, whatever shopping we needed to do. And Mirko became one of the guards. And most other guards were very familiar faces. Some former teachers were there as well. And there was a constant reign of terror in this place. Conditions in the camp were incredible, but you can survive, you know, poor conditions if you don't change your clothes for 2.5 months, as I didn't. You can survive on very little food. I mean, I lost 1/3 of my weight. You can survive that as well. And you can put on weight if you survive. But the terror that I luckily survived has followed me to this day. And this lasted for about 2.5 months, and I was not meant to be here. It's a long story. Bosnian Serb leader Radovan Karadžić invited journalists to come to visit this place, which he said didn't exist. So some journalists took his offer. They came to this camp, and I say they basically saved my life. And so when I came to when I was in the camps, I had no luxury of asking myself, why is this happening? Surely my neighbors know that I'm not a threat to them. My survival instinct kicked in. I just wanted to live through another day. But when I came out, I started asking myself all those questions. And it lasted for years. I couldn't find any answers. And at that time, there weren't any answers. I wanted to understand. And during that time, I described myself as being in a victim stage. I had moments of rage when I imagined actually killing my torturers without having any feelings whatsoever. But then I'd realize in those thoughts that it was the last thing I needed to do, because then I would completely lose myself, because in a way I haven't killed anyone, but I realized that had I done something like that, I would probably, there would be nothing else to live for. So I refused actually to hate. I've been kind of coaching myself for all these years not to hate. I have moments of anger even today. I mean, I'm involved in projects in Bosnia which cause a lot of anger. And I'd say that hate is not good, but I'd say anger is good. It can be good. It's a natural response, but it's got to be controlled. Otherwise, then unfortunately, we're talking about evil here today. If we don't control anger, then we do evil things. I went back to Bosnia for the first time 10 years after my village was attacked, and after I ended up in the Omarska camp, I was searching for some answers. And I was after my middle school teacher who interrogated me in the camp, so I wanted him to help me perhaps find some of those answers to some of those questions. And it was a fascinating encounter, because he was in complete denial. He was blaming me for what happened. And I also realized perhaps he couldn't explain himself what went on. I wanted to know how this teacher, whom I respected a lot in school, who was well-loved by all the students, a very intelligent person, could become involved in something like this. And interestingly, he wanted me to forgive him, but at that point in time, I just couldn't do that. I thought, how can I forgive someone who will not accept that he did anything wrong? And at this point in time, he was drunk at 10 o'clock in the morning, so he was an alcoholic, so something was bothering him. And unfortunately, a couple of years later, he died. I never had a chance to see him again, because I say unfortunately because I was thinking about forgiveness for a number of years, and it was a terrible burden. And I always thought of what my forgiveness would do to my torturers. I didn't think beyond that. And then, amazingly, one day I was preparing for work, I was having a shower, and I just said, I forgive you. And I wish that I had another opportunity to meet him after this moment, because I would tell him that I forgave him, because he was no evil man. There isn't much time, but I regularly come across people who have committed crimes in the Amarska camp, who were convicted for those crimes. So they're convicted war criminals. Just last year, I was traveling from the Bosnian capital to my village. Funnily enough, at 2:30 in the morning, I was to leave the train in the Amarska village, and I couldn't open the door on the train, so the train left the station, and there was one of the convicted war criminals who was my neighbor standing in the carriage, and I brushed against him. And I was thinking, even perhaps maybe I can go and talk to him, but I'm dead certain that he had a gun on himself, and so it wasn't a wise thing to do. But so I have forgiven them, but I just want to say that I do not exonerate criminals and their deeds. I do believe that they need to be, something has to be done about their crimes, but I just don't feel I should be the judge of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kamal. I'm just going to pose a couple of questions to the panel and then throw it over to you. The one I wanted to ask, which actually Kamal brought up towards the end, as we're called the Forgiveness Project, and we explore and we investigate. We are really a place of inquiry around forgiveness. We don't push or proselytize. That's really important. Because it is a word that seems to cut public opinion down the middle like a guillotine. And I certainly discovered when I was collecting the stories that people were either inspired or affronted by the notion of forgiveness. And the question I'm often asked is, how on earth can you forgive the unforgivable? How can you forgive people who show no remorse? How can you forgive those who do the most extreme acts of cruelty? So I'm going to ask the panel their views really around forgiveness and ask them to hold the mic very close, because otherwise people won't hear. Shall I start with you, Gwen?
Well, I guess my immediate thought is really what I was saying before, which is that it's something about, for me, opening up the potential, I suppose, is whether it's possible even to think about it. As you were speaking, Marina, I was finding myself wondering about the connections between forgiveness and compassion, and whether these are the same thing or related, or how they might work. And I guess for me, it's something about the readiness and whether people can be in a state of mind. In fact, Kamal, you've just touched on it, and brushing past somebody and that moment where you decide whether people are ready, whether you're ready to speak, whether they're ready to hear, and this is always being negotiated. But I guess, when I think of the work that you're doing here in the Forgiveness Project, is about exploring the possibility, just not collapsing and saying it's never possible or it's always possible, but just having the moment.
Yes, I tend to prefer using the word compassion, which really means empathy with suffering, with my own and with others. But eventually the word forgiving became alive to me. I never think of it as a noun. I find that much too, not sort of very much matching the process that I seem to have been in. So I talk about it as an ongoing verb. And to me, it's come down to how I live my everyday life. And it's been about a discipline of mindfulness in which I'm used to reflecting on feelings that are coming up within me and choosing how I express them, or really getting to understand that the sort of destructive emotions, or what in the Buddhism they call the afflictive emotions, always come from a place of self-centeredness. So I'm interested in how do I become less self-centered, because in that state you become naturally more empathic. But the whole thing of the word becoming alive was very much in this moment of what I call authentic connection with Rosemary West's suffering. And when I realized that the pain that I feel is, if I change the word because of what somebody's done to me to the word for someone else, so that they may be free from whatever has caused them to harm in the first place. That was the sort of insight I had in that moment. So just knowing, getting to know yourself and your own suffering and the feelings that we share in common as human beings, that for some people have been hugely exacerbated by terrible, difficult childhoods or war or whatever has made people feel more isolated and more hurt and more cut off. Though that's the place where you're more likely to harm from, and the place where you're more likely to move towards healing. I think of forgiveness as very much a place of healing, is the place where you have connected with a greater whole, where you have really experienced that we are all interconnected, and what we say and think and do does make a difference, and that to cut anybody off is like actually cutting out a piece of your own heart.
Well, thank you, Marion. Erwin, do you have thoughts?
Thoughts about forgiveness. That's a very difficult, for me personally, it's a very difficult concept, because I do have some experience of sort of being involved in the sort of idea of forgiveness. Again, when I was in prison, and the same lady who persuaded me that I had to, live and do the best I could, she also, I became fascinated by how we become who we become in prison. All the years I spent in my head, I had to try and figure out how I'd become what I'd become outside. Part of that process was exploring with the psychologist, my life journey beforehand. And, when I was a little boy, sort of things happened to me that I had no control over. I don't use that as an excuse, but I didn't know until I went to prison that a lot of what happened to me as a youngster wasn't my fault. I wasn't responsible for that. People who should have been caring for me it was their responsibility. And Joan said to me, "You've got to forgive those people," because I was struggling with so many different, ideas of trying to live on and make sense of my situation. And I thought, well, how do you do that? How do you forgive someone? How do you do that? You sort of get on your knees? Do you sort of shout to the heavens? Do you write them a letter? She said, no, you just forgive them. And in my cell, in my prison cell, I thought about certain people, and I forgave them. And it was very liberating. It was very liberating. I wouldn't, I was in a prison a little while ago, very briefly, and I was talking to some guys, and somebody said to me, I want to write a letter to my victim. And I said, yeah. He said, any advice? I said, you've got to think about your motives in writing that letter. Is it because you want approval? You want forgiveness because it will make you feel better? Or you want them to feel some peace and feel your remorse? And he couldn't answer me. And until you can answer that sort of question, I think, I'm not sure that I can answer that question either.
Oh, thank you. Kamal, do you have something to add from what you were saying before?
I'd say forgiveness is, I haven't got a definition of forgiveness, so I haven't read anybody else's definition of forgiveness. For me, forgiveness is about so many different things. I didn't say when I was talking, I was thinking what my forgiveness would do for others. So when I reached that point, I realized that I actually gave myself a new lease of life by doing something like that. But at the same time, when I get an opportunity to speak to people face to face, it's happened once that I'm giving them another chance as well. And it's about repairing relationships, it's about healing communities, it's about so many different things, and it's one of the most important things in this life. And I can only speak this way now because I know what it's done for me, and I know what it can do for everybody else.
Thank you, Kamal. I'm just going to ask a quick other question that I just wondered if we could just talk about gender, and I'll go to you, Gwen. It seems that men, it seems that they're more violent and certainly prone to what we call evil. But I wonder if that's right, or is evil equally distributed between men and women?
She sneaks these things in, you see. She said, she actually, when we first talked to me, she said there'd be a small seminar, about 50 people. Yeah. No difficult questions at all. There's a very straightforward statistical answer, which is I think there isn't any doubt that when it comes to acts of physical violence, people with Y chromosomes outnumber those without by a considerable proportion. And quite why that is a very interesting thing, because of course there's nothing about being male that makes you violent, as the huge populations of non-violent men will attest. Yeah? So there's nothing about being male that makes you violent. However, if you're going to be violent, it does seem like you're much more likely to be male. So that's an interesting problem, and actually I would suggest that this is one of the big Nobel Prize winning questions of the 21st century. Why are violent men so more numerically frequent than violent women? My only sense is when it comes to doing cruel and unusual things to other people, the actual state of mind is pretty much the same in men and women. And the women I've been involved with, whose cases I've been involved with, the state of mind is pretty similar, but they're numerically far fewer. And that seems to me to be very interesting. And if anybody's got a quick and easy, simple answer, please let us all know, because it would be very interesting.
Marion, I thought perhaps you might have something to say about this, given that Rosemary West has featured.
Well, yes. I would agree with Gwen that the actual state of mind that one could describe as evil must be shared between women and men. It's just... the sort of cultural differences, and I think that there's a sort of sense that women are expected not to behave in this way, although, and we seem to have become much more accepting of the fact that men do. So when someone like Rosemary West, Myra Hindley, Lady Macbeth, when there is a female perpetrator, I feel that possibly they are more demonized in a way than men. And I would think that it's a really difficult question, right? I don't know that I can say anything more, really.
Well, maybe someone in the audience has got someone to add to it. I don't know if either of you have got anything to say about gender, women, or... I mean, Kamal, whether... female perpetrators in your concentration camp?
Well, all perpetrators were men, but when I was being transferred to another camp, just outside the camp gates, there was a group of women and children, a lot of women and children, and they were shouting, kill them, kill them. It was not men, you know, shouting, kill them. And perhaps I can use another example. A Bosnian Serb wartime leader, Radovan Karadzic, he's in The Hague on trial right now for basically most things that happened during the war. But I met a British guy who was involved in negotiations between different sides during the war, and he said that this man, Karadzic, he would accept a deal and he would leave and to speak to his wife. And she'd tell him that he's weak and, you know, then he'd... and he wouldn't be prepared to... to deal with those from the other side anymore, and she's a woman. I don't like to differentiate when we talk about this topic between men and women. I believe there's a, I think, not every individual, but there's a murderer in each one of us. And I know that there's one in me. I just have to keep him in his place.
Thank you, Kamal.
I'll just say quickly, you know, because I don't want to go back. My, you know, I guess being here is because I, you know, I didn't really want to come, if I'm honest, but I owed it to Marina and anyone who, you know, needs to hear the voice of someone like me, like I was, you know. But I look back at the people, you know, a couple of people who really caused me serious harm when I was a little boy were women. Well, one particular was a woman, you know. She was, I'm not going to say she was evil, but she was dysfunctional. My father used to beat the hell out of her in front of us all. I mean, it wasn't my mother was sort of not around. She was killed in a car crash, and my dad sort of took on odd relationships with vulnerable women, actually, afterwards. And they were all very dysfunctional households, but the first woman that he ended up with, he was, you know, he used to beat her terribly. And she consequently started to sort of beat me, you know, the broom handle. I think I got the brunt of my dad's behavior from her. And I wouldn't say she was evil. I think they were vulnerable. My dad wasn't evil. He was dysfunctional. He was, you know, he'd been very violently abused as a kid. And, you know, these are not excuses, by the way, but there's some reasons as to how we become who we become, you know.
Yeah. Thank you. Now, could our helpers please come down here and just take a couple of mics? And if you've got a comment or a question, please put up your hands. We can only take them from down here, so I'm really sorry, people upstairs. If you really want to ask a question, come down.
My name's Charlie Ryder. I'm an outreach worker at Wormwood Scrubs Community Chaplaincy. I'd like to say thank you to Marion, because I used to edit an arts magazine for prisoners, and her story inspired some of the prisoners that I worked with on their journeys. And my question that I wanted to kind of ask is around the importance of healing and how that can help people to forgive themselves and to forgive other people, and the different forms of healing. And because of my work within prisons, it's the people that do the 12-step programs and who do the courses and things that are able to do this healing and do arts and do poetry. It opens them up to looking at this issue of forgiving themselves and forgiving other people. So my question is around different forms of healing. Do they work towards helping people forgive themselves and forgive others?
I won't say very much, except to say I think that's a really interesting idea, though, isn't it? That I know that some of our people are a bit lost to start with. I was running a group this afternoon in which a couple of guys were looking very jaundiced indeed. We were doing mindfulness practice, and somebody said completely audibly, "I can't stand this New Age crap." And I thought, bit of work to do, but I'm just what you've just said just now makes me think about whether we should, you know, whether this guy actually needs words. Maybe he needs a poetry class instead. But that's just a random thought.
Are you meaning specific practices? Because I'm just thinking along the lines of what happens when we share our stories in prison, and how that actually, I think, helps people to be more vulnerable about their own lives and to share more of what they need to face and accept within themselves. And that, interestingly, quite often, people find themselves writing poetry as part of this process that we do with them, although it's not something that we actually do formally. But I think it's wonderful that people find these words coming up within them. And I'm thinking of one man in particular who, in Bristol prison, who wrote to me after I'd been in there, and I think I'd said what happened in our family was like the ultimate burglary, and he was in there for drug-related burglary. And he asked the police to take him to his house where he'd left things that he hadn't been caught for. And then he asked them to drive him past the houses and give the things back and tell them he was sorry. And then when he got back to prison, he wrote me a letter telling me about this and how he'd really realised that his crimes were affecting other people. It had completely affected him. And then he wrote a poem at the end, and later on I sent him, we kept in correspondence, I sent him a book of Lucy's poems, and he continued to write poetry. And for him, finding words was his way towards healing. And then I gave him some oil pastels and paper as well, and he started drawing. That was another. So I think finding an expression is vitally important, a creative way of acknowledging your life.
Do you want to add something?
I'll just pick quickly. You know, I was in prison for those 2 decades, but, and I have to tell you that I have no great, I don't look back with fondness on most of the people that I met in those places, I have to tell you. But I met very few people, and I met every kind of offender, every kind of perpetrator, every type you can imagine. I was on the landings with people who'd committed every kind of offence you can imagine. I met very few people who didn't want to be more than they'd been, didn't have remorse. I'm not a spokesman for prisoners or criminals, but my experience was that the people around me, you know, carried great shame, great guilt, and looked for ways to try and make some amends. For people, when you've been convicted, like I was, of murder, you can't really make amends. All you can try and do is do the best you can. Part of that was through, you know, being exposed to the arts, to education. I can't believe that I went to prison to get my education, but I did. I'd had a very disjointed sort of, you know, youth and childhood, so my education was very limited. But when I went to prison, I got access to education, access to the arts, and it helped me. Being exposed to creativity allowed me to find that better part of me that was deep inside and that was buried in there, you know. And so I always champion the arts in prisons. It's difficult when you're a victim of crime, because I've heard spokespeople for victims' organizations, you know, talking about rehabilitation. We don't want any part in rehabilitation of these people, you know. Rehabilitation is, for people like I was, you know, is an affront, is an insult to victims. This is what a lot of people, and they, you know, hold powerfully those feelings. And I've got to accept that. I totally accept it. But the thing is, if we let people out of prison, people like I was, we have to let them out better than they were. You know, they're going to be somebody's neighbor. We have to let them out so that they're good neighbors, so that they're good citizens. And part of that process, Charlie, was being exposed for me to the arts, you know.
Thank you. Should we take another question down here? I think that mic's working now.
Thank you.
Briefly, please.
Thank you. My name is Milius, and I'm the director of the Fellowship of Reconciliation England. Would the panel say forgiveness was a necessary condition for healing and reconciliation? And if so, where do you go to learn forgiveness?
Well, reconciliation and forgiveness, I think, are different things. You can become reconciled to something, but you... It seems to me that the bit of the journey we seem to have forgotten about is the bit from revenge to forgiveness, and that that's why I love being involved with the Forgiveness Project, because it is an educational process, and it is about reminding people that there is actually something beyond revenge, and that it actually is ultimately for their good and for the good of humanity, and it gives them more of a sort of sense of hope and a way forward that can be transforming for them. So, I mean, when I made this vow to forgive the West, I had no idea how to do it or even what it meant, but I think making that commitment, what I did experience was that everything I needed for that journey came into my life. And so I began to have faith in that as a way forward. In fact, the only creative, imaginative way forward involved this mysterious process. And I don't think it's something that you can will. I think it's something that you commit yourself to and that you open yourself to. And it's just something about remaining open to what is actually coming into your life and being true to that, that somehow makes the way forward. And as Kamal said, you know, he was just having a shower and suddenly he felt he could forgive. You know, you don't know when these moments are going to arise. And I think they're very much about, to me, I would use the word grace.
I'd actually say that reconciliation comes before forgiveness. I was not able to forgive those who perpetrated those crimes against me until I was in a position to reconcile myself with my own past, with my own experiences. So I would say it works the other way around, speaking from my experience.
Thank you. Is there anyone else?
Just a moment of devil's advocacy. I just want to know what you would think about the suggestion that in some ways to nurture a flame of hatred for someone like Fred West could be cleansing, could be the flame from which the phoenix arises. And connected with that, the thought that those who pursued, the Nazi hunters who pursued those who killed, you know, the men whose pictures we saw up there, that those Nazi hunters were fueled by a flame of pure hatred. And in that sense, that was an instrument of justice.
Thank you. Very good question. I'll ask Marin maybe just to answer this thing about nurturing a flame of hatred for the Wests.
I think there is such a thing as righteous indignation. I think a flame of hatred would be something that would be utterly corrupting of my spirit. I don't see that it would have... I have experienced what I would call a purification through fire and water of really deeply crying and expressing this furious, involuntary rage that I mentioned. But they were sort of part... It was almost like getting to the depth of the grief and the rage, but not... And by doing that, somehow being freed from them. So it was important to know the depth of those feelings. But I think to see that, to nurture a flame of hatred sounds deeply dangerous to me and corrupting of my human potential.
Okay, we're going to try and get a couple more questions. There's a man over here, please.
For the perpetrators of crimes, forgiveness isn't always forthcoming or even available. Under those circumstances, what does it mean for the perpetrators to forgive themselves, and is that of value?
That's a question about whether perpetrators should forgive themselves, and is it of value if they do? I think maybe I'll ask you, Owen, to...
How the hell do I answer that question? You know, my a few years ago, I wrote an article in the Guardian. I was getting a bit of interest in me. I became a writer in prison, and my Irwin James, my full name is Irwin James Monaghan, and I sort of used Irwin James as a means of discretion to try and put some distance between me and the perpetrator of these my awful crimes. I wrote an article trying to hide my past. I won't go into the details of it, but I foolishly sort of wrote a piece and sort of was very cagey about my whereabouts in 1982 when my crimes were committed, when I committed my crimes. I had some exposure after that in the Mail on Sunday, sort of revealed all my gory details of my past, my victims, photographs, details of the prosecution. And it was really a difficult time because I didn't know how to... Nobody sort of helped me or coached me on how to be a member of society post-prison, especially someone who became a writer for a national newspaper. That was never in my plans. And I had to sort of cope with this
this interest in me that I'd never anticipated. I just wanted to be a writer because it was something I found I was good at, you know. But following that, I had emails from people connected to my victims. The first one was very angry. Very angry. She'd been reading my articles for years, admired Irwin James, the writer, then discovered I was the perpetrator of the murder of her friend. I emailed back, I responded. It was difficult. All I could do was apologize. Well, you know, it seemed futile, you know, forgiveness, Christ. It was very difficult, you know. And I offered my number and said, look, anything you need to say to me, please, you know, feel free to say whatever you like, your anger, your hatred. And it was very difficult to cope with that. But then I had another email from someone else who said, talking about one of my victims, said, he'd be very proud of you, what you've achieved. And that was equally difficult to read that. And so, you know, people talk about forgiving yourself. When you have the guilt of something that you can't put right, you know, you can't sort of make better. When you talk about forgiveness, we do get a lot of that in prison. I have to tell you, chaplains, you've got to forgive yourself. You know, the Lord forgives you, you know. Everybody forgives you. But you've got to forgive yourself. You think, how the hell do you do that? I'm forgiven. I'll move on now. And it was grim, but let's move on. You know, that's not really an option. You're stuck with it. You know, I'm glad I discovered in prison that I had a conscience. I didn't realize beforehand. I was so stuck on surviving this vile life that I had. My conscience really didn't kick in until I had time to reflect on what I'd become, you know. It's a complicated, convoluted answer to your question, but I was almost going to say I'm happy to live without forgiveness. I just exist in this state, and my plan is to keep going as long as I can and do the best I can till it's all over. That's my plan.
Thank you, Alan. We've got time for just one more question. What about the lady in the blue standing up? Just the last question, thank you.
I was removed by that, and I wonder, I was struck listening to your presentation, Dr. Adshead, that despite the sort of acknowledgement of the sort of influences on some of the people you work with, that there was still a strong emphasis on agency, and I wonder whether, given how actually precious little control any of us have over the influences that shape us, whether you think there are cases where it's cruel or at least dishonest to maintain the notion that people had some sort of agency in committing whatever crimes they committed.
Ooh. Well, I'll tell you a story. Somebody I worked with in the hospital, when we still had women patients in the hospital, she was a woman who had been found to be legally insane at the time of the killing. She had killed a young care worker in a hostel, and she'd been found to be legally insane. And for those of you who don't know, that means that at the time of the killing, she was thought to be, that she didn't know what she was doing, and or she didn't know it was wrong. And in that circumstance, you are found innocent of the crime, but you're deemed to be insane. So if you've committed a criminal offence, you get held in hospital. So she had been found legally insane, sent to a hospital, and she was very much told, that she had a long history of mental illness. You know, your mental illness made you do this, and what you need to do now is to take the medication that will stop you becoming mentally ill again. Okay. And then, for reasons I still don't really understand, they asked me to see her. And it was very interesting because they said, will you see her, just find out if there's any other reason that she might have killed this young woman?
which is interesting because we already had an explanation. We had schizophrenia, the psychosis made you do it. Take the meds, no psychosis, you'll be fine. You were found legally, you know, you were found to be legally insane, so not innocent, not guilty by reason of insanity. No. So she had a whole narrative available to her that said, you are not guilty. But she felt guilty. And in the work with me, she talked about feeling guilty and about feeling shattered and about how suicidal she'd felt while she was on remand waiting for her trial because she felt in pieces. And we, it was an extraordinary woman. I mean, it was really, but it was a very dense type of work that we did around this issue about guilt and her sense of wanting to put it behind her, whatever the it was. And if we had more time, I'd tell you about another man who was again thought to be chronically psychotic, medication. Oh, not much time, not much point in you talking to Dave. You know, Dave's chronically ill. You know, killed two people when he was ill. But in the homicide group, Dave came up with all sorts of very interesting comments, which suggested that he had been thinking quite a lot about his state of mind. So I'd be a bit reluctant to close down the door, really, on any type of dialogue. But I guess it's a question of where you start, apropos our question from the chaplain. Where do you start, and how do you pace the work? And who's ready, and are you ready to hear what's been said? And are we training enough people? You know, and it doesn't matter, when I say train, I don't mean particularly special professional training, but do we have enough workers in the vineyard to be ready to hear what needs to be said? And I guess the Forgiveness Project is part of that.
Thank you. I just want to say thank you for those great questions. I'm sorry we couldn't take more or carry on the conversation. I think you get a flavour of the kind of conversations we have in the prisons and the schools and all the places we go to talk about this subject. And forgiveness is really a very, very complex subject. You never quite ever get to the bottom of it. And when Gwen was talking about a work in progress, I often think that the Forgiveness Project is a work in progress as well. It's unfinished and messy sometimes, and that's just how it is, and we're very comfortable with that. I just want to end by mentioning an aspect of our work going forward, our future. As everybody knows, these are really, really difficult and challenging times for fundraising. I just read the other day that 400 small charities closed last year. And while we're not directly affected by government cuts, we are because there's so many more organisations out there scrabbling around for the same pots of money. So one thing I always hold on to, and I've certainly held on to it going forward into our ninth year, is that so many people from all around the world have a deep connection and a passion for this work. And we know this because there isn't a day that goes by when someone doesn't ring or write or email to say thank you for the online stories that I've just come across and the resources which have really helped and given me hope and motivation to deal with all the difficulties that people are grappling with in their own lives. And those might be personal or public, or it might also be political. So with this in mind, in January, we did what I'm sure other charities have done as well, but it felt very precious to us. We started what is called a tiered supporters program, really aimed at asking those people who feel this deep connection with us with this work to support us and help us through. And tiered in the sense that just for £5 a month, you can become a friend. And then the more you give, you either become a guardian or an ambassador. So there's a sense of ownership and a connection between us and our supporters. And I was really moved and heartened that after that first appeal, those people who did respond to that first appeal, some of you are here tonight, and there were people who really, I could see, believed in what we were doing to transform the lives, not only of people who have been hurt, but also people who have hurt others, and also to educate and inform young people around alternatives to violence. And us in the office, we thought, well, we can't expect people to give if we're not prepared to give ourselves. So we joined the supporters program, and then all the trustees joined it. And about 50 or so of
all our, you know, on our database. But it was still, I have to say, a really, really tiny proportion. So that's why I'm going to end the evening, only because it is literally about our future, with an appeal to you. There is a leaflet on all of your seats to consider supporting our supporters program and securing our future going forward. But I really want to end by saying a huge thank you to all the speakers and to Dr. Gwen Adshead for bringing, I think, real moral authority to the conversation this evening. And thank you to you for coming as well.